Stephen Sacks, author of The New Fundamentals. We're going through some unprecedented times. How do you describe them?
I think this is the first impactful event that we've had as a country since 9/11, where there are some similarities and there are certainly some distances. The similarities, I think, have to do with the fact that we're making great advances in marshaling the necessary forces that we can have to react and counteract what has been going on. We got attacked. We have 3,000 people that were killed, in New York and in Washington and in Pennsylvania. What we have now is on a greater scale because it's not done by per se human events, armaments and such, but it was caused by a transfer of a virus that was initially confined to animals and then got transferred to humans. So it's an unknown, that's why they call it the novel coronavirus. But again, we are making efforts in cajoling United States citizens to come together, to do what is right, to help their neighbor, to think about what they can do from a public service perspective. And it's because of this that we're hoping, and I think that the one greater aspect or hopeful impact that this will have is that it's going to change the way we as a society go about our daily lives. That it's not just we're in this bubble, or echo chamber that we're focused on, if we're talking accounting profession or legal profession, just on clients, just from a business standpoint. It's going to get more personal. I think there's this wish for a greater level of patriotism that was redolent of the World War I, World War II, where sacrifices were made. And when we come out of this, when it's dissipated or the crisis has been averted, that this was not just a temporary blip in patriotism, but that it was now something that is practice from now on. And one of the things I think about is personal hygiene. Never gave it a thought. I'm not going to get into things that I observed or I've blogged about, talked to people about, but it's the first thing of how we as individuals have to deal with one another in an in-person position. And maybe reprioritizing what we think is important. Because we all know, Rick, that we're all creatures of habit. So there's a time where we say, let's get back to the way we once were, with the strong fabric of American society. And then when things are averted or they dissipate, whatever that crisis might be, we go back to being creatures of habit. And I hope that this will be a tipping point where we don't go back to being creatures of habit, that these learnings will now be embedded into our frontal lobes, and that we now change the way that we deal with our families, we deal with our friends, we deal with our colleagues and clients, students, a whole plethora of demographics.
How will the accounting business be changed?
I think that there's always been talk over the past number of years about the diminished value of the financial audit, because you have bankers, certain asset lenders, what have you, have not been demanding to have a full-fledged audit. Maybe they'll be happy with a compilation or review, a little bit of due diligence. And that's the way that the thinking has evolved way before the coronavirus. Now I think it is presenting a stark contrast to real value-added services, because what it has caused now is this whole broad opening of opportunities in the consulting services arena. The way I see it is that the CPAs, being the trusted advisor, will be able to go ahead and help their clients and potential clients in business recovery services. You know, a company leader is not going to say, oh, this is what you're giving me. This is an audit. I know what it's going to show. It's going to show lousy numbers. How are you going to help me to get back on my feet? What are some of the things that you're going to do besides the due diligence and taking a look at pension covenants and contracts and such? You know, I may, as I'm talking about a business owner, because of what went on, I've lost my supply chain has been broken, big disconnection. Some of my suppliers have gone out of business. How am I going to be able to recover that lost business? And I create another branch or another outlet for new suppliers. Maybe I have to change the way the things that I do. Maybe I have to alter the way my businesses are running. Maybe I have to get into a new type of product line. These are the types of things, considerations that the CPA is going to be asked by their clients to look at. Key performance indexes, building digital dashboards for clients, making projections, doing more complex data analytics. We talked about data analytics being a growing area now, along with blockchain technology and artificial intelligence. But right now, this is not something that we're looking at as a slow progression of work that will help the profession evolve. But we need this stuff right now, because once the virus is averted, it dissipates, and the dust settles, the CPA is going to have to be in closer contact with their clients. How could we help? You know, what are some of the immediate needs you have? What resources can we help you leverage? So I think the whole mindset is going to certainly go away from the compliance aspect. And that includes, you know, audit, other types of assurance services, and tax. Tax, of course, is going to be around. But I think the value-added services are no longer going to be a luxury that only certain firms will afford. It's going to be something that is needed on demand. That's one of the ways that I think, or one of the areas that I think the CPA profession is going to evolve.
Let me ask it this way. Are most CPAs capable of upping their game for value-added services?
I think you'll find that there are firms now, predictably your top 10, top 15 firms, that to some way, shape, or form have been providing these services. But as you start to push down to the lower level of the firms, no, I don't think that they have focused on. What they've been focusing on is in the technology space, you know, using the tools in a way that assumes everything will continue on the way it is. And of course, you have, as I said, cloud computing, you know, the blockchain, things of these nature. But those are tools. What it requires now is in past years, when prior to the Securities Act of 1933, 1934, where you needed a certified financial audit, prior to that, the CPA was always considered a trusted business advisor, because that the client will say, how can you help me grow my business? Whether it was a dry cleaners or whether it was a candy manufacturer. And then, of course, we became more compliance oriented during the later years, until 1960s, when the Big Eight at that time started going back into the consulting services, and then there were issues and problems, conflicts of interest, etc. But now with Sarbanes-Oxley going back a number of years, and how they separated, doing the test or assurance services from consulting, you know, there's a way to, you know, avoid those problems. So I think that at this point, CPAs could be positioned, if they take a look at what their clients need, how does that translate in the CPE that their staff needs, and not the stuff that you need for state requirements or AICPA requirements, but true services that you will need, or skills that you will need. It will also impact how they hire, who they hire. I mean, right now, there's been a diminution of the number of pure audit students, those graduating with an accounting degree that know the audit and tax, but those now are involved in data analytics and finance, which will be another type. Businesses are going to change domestically. The processes are going to change internationally. How are the firms going to be handling this? So I think at some point, rather than firms maybe buying other firms, you know, that they can bring in, you know, to help them with this initial influx of education and skills, they may do joint ventures. They may, you know, get together for a certain type of work and, you know, borrow from each other's skills and be able to provide services to these clients. I also think, and this is going to be a continuing trend, is MBAs are going to be the big competitors to CPAs. Those that have maybe had cursory understanding of financial statements, but those who have have been instilled with a lot of knowledge in finance and technology. So the CPA firms, I think going forward, are, along with technology, are going to start, this is my own personal thing, are going to start to look more like McKinsey's and Bain's and maybe a mixture of little Silicon Valley thrown in. So that may change the whole model and tray of offerings that are provided because of this, the coronavirus. So some of it has been occurring prior to this pandemic, but I think it's going to be on quite an ascendant trajectory going forward.
This pandemic is going to create winners and losers among accounting firms. Can you tell by looking at how a firm is operating today whether it's going to be a winner or a loser?
I think you have to take a look at what some of them have done over the past couple of years, how they may have changed, maybe getting into new sectors or new specialties. How have they cultivated new talent? Did they build or buy? You take a look at firms, maybe their statistics over the last 3 or 4 or 5 years, and they're still hovering around the same revenue that they've had through those years. So you might say that they have a level of comfort that they have their book of business and they're fine with it. I don't think those are going to be the ones to survive. I think those who have thought ahead of the curve to do some of the more complex type services are better situated to adapt to these new changes. I think there are going to be some firms, it's unavoidable, they're going to take a look and say, you know, we don't have the in-house intellectual horsepower here. We're just going to have to merge upward and be able to, survive, just be part of something bigger. And you know what, Rick, it's not anything different than the last couple of years where firms have taken a look, especially those who wanted to retire. You know, they take a look around the boardroom and they don't see anybody who could be a natural successor. So, you know, they want an exit package for themselves. So they look around and for other firms with whom they could be acquired. And now that's going to go, I think, exponentially faster. You know, the old adage, if you don't grow, you die. So stagnation is really, the poisonous fruit of the tree. You can't grow. You can't innovate. You're just looking to protect what you have. Now, clients have become a lot more sophisticated over the years, and they can see, they talk to their competitors. Who's serving you? What's your CPA saying? What are they doing? Finding out that they're getting really served by their competitors, and they think to themselves, why hasn't my CPA told me about this? So that's another problem that some of the smaller or mid-sized firms face. Again, it goes back to my early thesis, which is financial audit is not going to be meaningful at this point. And in fact, I may add that if it's 12/31 year-end audit was finally delivered to the client on March 31, and they just finished their first quarter, and now they're being handed a snapshot of what happened the prior year without any prognostication or insight as to what it means for the upcoming year, I think further solidifies the view that an audit is really not of much use going forward. Now, some people may take umbrage at that, but I think if you're going to tell somebody what happened the prior year, you're leaving open the other half of the equation is, what can you do for me this year? Where can I expect to be?
So this pandemic and the ensuing economic restructuring throughout the economy could restructure and transform the accounting business. Will it be recognizable?
Will the profession be recognizable? I'll play devil's advocate, I think. One of the theories been thrown around, and maybe the next few years, the current model of the CPA firm might not be recognizable anymore. Maybe the partnership model is self-defeating. Maybe it'll go into a more corporate structure where accountability performance is going to be looked at with a more jaundiced eye by the leaders, senior leaders in the partner group. And it's not going to just be, what have you done with your book of business? Fine, but what have you done to grow your book of business? I think that the more forward-thinking firms are going to look at competition outside of the accounting profession. They're going to look at what consultants are doing out there. What are clients, their clients, asking for? You know, the ones that are being served by Bain and Boston Consulting Group and McKinsey and so on and so forth. And they'll say, you know what? I think we can do this. I mean, after all, we've built our understanding of businesses, you know, through the audit. Okay, but that, again, is not going to be the end all be all. We must find ways to convey our value proposition to show why we're more valuable or we're more insightful to help your company versus those non-CPA consulting firms. I don't think it's going to be unrecognizable, the accounting profession. I think it's going to, there has to be some way to hold on to a brand to, and then build on that brand. And that's going to take some serious consideration because, you know, it's got to go beyond, you know, how much can you save me in taxes this year? But, you know, Rick, it's, you know, we're not fortune tellers what's going to happen in the next 5 or 10 years. But again, the education is going to have to change in the undergraduate and graduate levels. There's got to be more emphasis on business philosophy, business writing, presentations, maybe a debate-like forum between two students and somebody serving as a client or volunteer from a local business to come in and teach them these things. Because after all, what you have are students that come in and the first, I don't know, 6 months, 8 months, depending upon the flow of the work, they're in, you know, back in the day, what we call the bullpen, waiting to be called on by a partner, you know, to work on an engagement. But right now, maybe they need to be inculcated with the types of knowledge they need to, how to deal with a client in a client meeting and a proposal and things of these nature, because you're looking at, as a senior partner, you're looking at who are going to be the future leaders of my firm, who are going to be the stars. So I think the usual way of indoctrinating the CPA students, young professionals, is going to be more on a fast track and a more entrepreneurial type approach rather than going through some audits or tax returns. Because if you only do that, you're not understanding why you're doing that. You're not having any contact with the client to really understand. And I think it's up to partners to take the younger people under their wing. They don't have to say anything in a meeting. They can just sit and listen to their partner, ask the type of questions, listen to what the client has to say, and to understand how that rapport and trust is engendered and cultivated. So in certain ways, today's practices are going to change to get the younger people more up to speed. And of course, that goes hand in hand with no longer the 12 or 13 year trek to become a partner. It's 34, 35. You know this as well as anyone else, that a number of firms are looking to make partners at the age of 28, 29. And maybe it's out of necessity because of people who are retiring and they need to fill that pipeline.
Considering the massive changes you're talking about, considering the fact that firms are going virtual right now, whether they like it or not, considering the fact that many firms were unprepared at this moment in tax season to do this kind of thing, how is it different managing a distributed virtual firm of high value advisors?
At the beginning, when telecommuting started to make its presence known, the first thought was, well, I can only limit it, you know, to those people that I trust, who I trust. And then, of course, going into their homes and making sure there are no OSHA violations and other matters, and to make sure that they had the infrastructure, such as solid connectivity and a phone, that they had the work ethic, that I could trust them, you know, to put in the 8 hours. That was the model thinking back then. Today, the firms are saying, you know, we talk about cloud computing, we talk about these other applications, we talk about trying to build a collaborative team-based environment, and I would be remiss if I didn't include this, firms are toward the end of their leases, and they're deciding whether do we need to renew our lease? Do we have to have the same square footage? Can we have our people working from home so that we don't have all these capital costs? So that's a consideration. I think with telecommuting now, you have to make sure that your people don't feel isolated. Just because you don't have that face-to-face interaction, you still need to have regular, concise, comprehensive, consistent communications. You know, those firms that used to, there are firms that are still working, you know, in their bricks and mortar in their building, and the senior management would do, let's say, a weekly or a monthly video conference, teleconference to let everybody know what's going on while they were in the office. That should be no different now that they're at home. So they should be able to maintain that flow of communication and let them know what the plans are for the firm. It's very important, because if people don't feel that they're getting the type of update that they need or plans that the firm has, it sort of cultivates mistrust and skepticism. So you need to limit that, mitigate that. I think that people are going to learn to be, I think, better at time management, at prioritizing, you know, through their telecommuting. I think, of course, it would help firms in attracting, you know, new talent, because they want to go with firms, you know, that use these current and futuristic type of tools, the telecommuting, the use of social media for business development, and you know, a whole myriad of other factors. So I think that if they do it right, it will help the firms attract and maintain their talent.
What's the most important thing firms have to be thinking and doing during this critical crisis transitional period?
It's a two-part answer. I think once they get a handle on having implemented and practiced their crisis communication or crisis management by putting in the right tools and the right people, technology, and constant communication with their clients, it reminds me that of what President Kennedy once said, and that is, the best time to put on a roof is when the sun is shining, meaning that don't wait until it hits the fan, but do it when you're relaxed and take a look at the big picture, learn from other things. I mean, because one of the things that firms are going to do when this is over, they're going to take a look at, they'll do a retrospective. When went right? What went wrong? Where do we fill the gaps? Should, God forbid, another crisis of this magnitude occurs. The other, and this is usually considered more in the political realm, the quote was originally attributed to Rahm Emanuel, but I think it goes back further, and it says that a real crisis should never go to waste. And that is, again, the learnings, you know, what could we do? And I think it's not only to the individual practitioner, but I think to a government standpoint as well. Take a look at some of the things that can be done. Their universities, of course, have always looked at telelearning, but I think it's going to become more and more of the way that things are done. Maybe it impacts tuition. Maybe it impacts the way the students will interact with one another. Healthcare, I mean, those who have healthcare clients start to talking about telehealthcare and putting in the type of technology tools they need to accomplish that. The tax code could be changed a bit to give more incentives for charitable contributions, you know, such as some of the things that are going on now with businesses, you know, helping states and counties with some of their works with, you know, personal protective equipment and the masks and gloves and gowns, et cetera. I think businesses, I think the CPAs might speak to businesses to engage more in environmental, social, and governance investing. I think, and this is a little bit of a tricky thing, I think those firms that deal with international trade, global trade, there's been a level of distrust that has arisen from this whole pandemic. And I don't know the impact that that's going to have going forward when things start to, you know, get normal again, because of, you know, how we as a country, supposedly the leader, has built up distrust among other countries. I think that trust has to be regained again, so that we could all work, you know, as one global company, if you will, from a governmental standpoint. And I think that if anything can be learned is that. That it shouldn't be something we dream about to help. It should be like automatic. I remember, I guess it must have been 8 years ago, 9 years ago, there was in Michigan, there was a firm that was had somebody come in, maybe fired. They came in and they shot some people. And this was during tax season. One of the things was when I was heading up my organization was to reach out to a couple of member firms in Michigan to, you know, here's the information, maybe you want to volunteer to help them, you know, complete the tax returns that couldn't because they were impacted by, you know, personnel being shot or killed. I mean, these are the type of things that scenario planning is going to, you know, be, I think, a very important thing, what if analysis. It just makes us less this and more this big picture. And I think the more we start to think about that, you know, advanced preparation, marshaling our forces, crisis management, crisis communication, I think we'll be better equipped, not only within the accounting profession and other professions, but I also think from local, county, state, and federal levels. And that's the thing that I think the one takeaway is, because the accounting profession isn't the only area that's been impacted by this. But the accountants can play a role because they could be, or they should be, a true partner in the success of their firms. And that's the way I look at it.
Steve Sachs, thank you very much.